much for coming tonight. I really appreciate it. And thank you to these esteemed panelists. I want to give a special thank you to Massimo for coming so far and doing so much while you're here. It's really appreciated. Just to set the conversation up a little bit, I've asked each of the panelists to prepare just a really short introduction that talks a little bit about who they are, what work they're involved in that pertains to our conversation. Massimo, please.
Hello. I'm gonna be very quick. So, I'm a chef. 32 years ago, I decided to give up my study on became a lawyer, and I decided to follow my passion. I opened a small restaurant in the country. 22 years ago, I opened Osteria Francescana. It's a small restaurant with big dreams. And, you know, we still now, after 22 years, having these amazing dreams and bigger and bigger. But never, ever, I would think about making something or became a food activist in this kind of, with this kind of big ideas and create a foundation Food for Soul with my wife, just to raise money using my image to open, to help to open and fight the food waste. 3 years ago, 4 years ago, I saw some numbers, which like 860 million people, they don't have anything to eat, and 1.4 that now is 1.9 billion are overweight, and 1.3 billion tons of food is wasted every year. The medium is like 33% of the food that we produce is waste. So when I had to confront the Universal Exposition that was in Milan 2 years ago, all the different nations, they start asking me as a referent or in Italy, as a chef, to be involved in many different situations. But they never, and no one asked us what we were thinking, really. What the meaning of feed the planet. And so I decide to create my own pavilion. And so this is one of the biggest dreams of my life. But I didn't have the money to do it. So I knock at the door of the church because I was thinking that with the new Pope, Pope Francis, it could be very open to an idea like this. They opened, they listened to what I had to say, and they said, thank you, it's a great idea. Thanks for your passion and your energy. Come back in 1 week and we'll let you know. And 1 week later, they said, we found the perfect space. It's a no theater, instead of being in the center of Milan, that is like, the center of the city. We would love to give some light, bring some light to the periphery of Milan, in a neighborhood, in the poorest neighborhood, where there's the home of the refugees, the poorest place in Milan, Quartiere Greco. And there is a very nice priest that is gonna help you. So we went there to find out what it could be, you know? And this guy, Don Giuliano, was looking at me, and instead of talking about the place or talking about what you want to do here, why you're here, he said, look at the train. The train is beautiful. Look, you see, the train is moving. That's the future. And if we can understand this kind of mentality, you know, we can make it. I look at him and said, this is the right person. This is really a guy who really can make the difference. And, you know, 1 year later, we open this place. We rebuilt, together with architects, involving artists, involving designer. We create an amazing place full of beauty. And because I want to rebuild something as Leonardo da Vinci did 500 years ago, but I want to do it better and more beautiful, very contemporary. And all the architects from the Polytechnic of Milan with Renzo Piano, they came, they look at the space, they rebuilt a beautiful space being with a lot of respect for the architecture of the 30s. The artists like Cookie, like Palladino, like Carlo Benvenuto, they created pieces just for this reason. And Nannucci, no more excuses, a 22 meters neon outside that was saying, no more excuses. Let's stop talking, let's start acting. And, you know, the designer, they create amazing tables as the communal tables of the monk they use, the Franciscan monks, in which you can confront the other, in which you can create a family. So the meaning of this was not just to create another soup kitchen. I think we didn't need another soup kitchen. We need a space that united people. We need a space that we rebuild the dignity of the people. We need the chef, their time, their knowledge, their creativity to create something and to fight against waste. For one night, dedicate one night, one day of their time to come down in Milan, unloaded the truck, and for one day put in the mind of my grandmother. Because when I grew up under the table of the kitchen, in the meantime that my grandmother was rolling pasta, I was stealing tortellini, but also I was going to bed asking for a warm cup of milk full of breadcrumbs, a little bit of sugar, and was my favorite meal. And look where I am. So I think after this, one day, we were in bed, it's 6 in the morning, I received a message, Cristina Suenda, from the mayor of Rio de Janeiro. The refettorio in Milan became the major idea of the Universal Exposition. And so the mayor of Rio said, during the Olympics, we really need a project like yours, and we're going to give you the space to build something like that. And so I put together a group of a team with Cristina, you know, and we rebuilt a space. Actually, in Milano, we rebuilt it. But here we had to build brand new because it was just a long aisle, like 48 meters long by 6 wide, with nothing, just darkness. Darkness in which, there was drug, people sleeping on the street. And so we said, why not? Why not? So we start with For Soul. And we, in 6 months, we did this, And we created an amazing place that now the gastromotiva, refettorio gastromotiva, the volunteers, they are running and they are like serving every night, you know, 100 people, and most of them a truck every day full. We save every day one truck full of vegetables and fruit. In the same way, here the chefs are coming from all over South America and all over the world. Because after the first approach we had in Milan, everyone wants to come back and dedicate their time to this kind of project. Because, you know, we really need their complicity and their spotlight to show to the younger generation and give the example to the young generation what is a real chef in 2017. That is, I think, is much more than the sum of their recipe. After Rio de Janeiro, we had the example of Modena, Bologna, and the next one is gonna be London. The 5th of June, we're gonna open London. In these 2 years, Food for Soul became a referment of this kind of activism. But most of everything is like, it becomes a center for, in which everyone of the chef community wants to be part of. And wants to come and give the example, and wants to share with the others. So this is what makes the difference. Sharing ideas with all the others. So next one is gonna be London. And just 2 weeks ago, we received a very important news from the Rockefeller Foundation, who gave us a big grant to organize and see the opportunity to open many soup kitchens in the United States. My idea. is for the Rockefeller Foundation. My idea is like, the first thing is like, my passion are music, art, and food. So first one could be New Orleans, you know, for what happened in the city, for the jazz and the community. Could be Detroit, you know, after everything and, you know, that happened. And the Bronx, the smallest, the poorest community in the United States. So I think it's very important to talk and to make, you know, to the more culture and the more information we bring and we share is extremely important. But it's also time to act. Thank you.
You know, thinking about what you said about changing one's perspective on waste, I think of the human waste involved in all of this, in the cycle, from growing to the slime we throw away from our produce bins, and just the amount of water and human, and to me more than anything, the human energy that goes into that which gets thrown away. Jenny, I want to ask you more about composting, because so many of us at home, and maybe Amy too, you can both get into this, I feel like I'm getting a lot of mixed messages about what I'm allowed to put into the green bin. I used to compost myself, but I did what Jenny said, not do it well. And I was very aware that I was creating a bigger problem. So I started using the green bin. And then I was told recently, no, you can't put coffee grounds in the green bin. You can't put this in the green bin or that in the green bin. And I'm thinking to myself, but it's all compostable. So why can't we?
Do you want me to take that one? I know this for you, but okay. Well, I'll be real quick. Just so you guys know, remember I mentioned before that, you know, we're eventually going to have to be doing this even from the residential side, but we started with commercial first. The reason why you can, here's the riddle of the Sphinx. The reason why you can't put your food waste currently into your green bin is because there are many composting facilities in Los Angeles County, but not one of them is permitted to take food waste. So when food starts to break down, you know how it smells in your garbage. Once this highly putrescible material gets into a normal composting facility, it's actually going to affect the methane gas emissions. So these facilities have to be permitted. And once you start getting into that kind of material, the regulations get a lot more complex.
Okay, so this makes me really crazy because I just think, issue everybody weekly bags of sawdust or some other carbonaceous material that we can layer into our green bins. Yeah. So that the composting process starts already in the green bin.
So the whole thing is it's coming. As soon as we can get our permitting in Los Angeles County and we have more ways to deal with this material, again, outside of landfill, then it's going to be in our green bins as well, which would be a really cool thing. Or you can backyard compost, but for now, you're not supposed to be putting it in there. Although we're not going to go through your bin either.
Okay, and Jenny, now I'm going to ask you about energy. Waste to energy. Are you aware of any projects that are models right now of either anaerobic digesters or any kind of innovative solutions that are scalable or already at scale?
Sure. I mean, a lot of wastewater treatment plants run anaerobic digesters and use that energy to power the plant. So it's definitely something that can work well in that.
And there's another facility that just opened in Paris, not Paris, Europe, but Paris, California. So it's an anaerobic digestion facility. Sorry. And so that just opened recently.
There's Naples in Florida, Paris, California.
There's a Paris, Texas too. But yes, Paris, California. And I think it's P-E-R-I-S. I've been out there. But anyway, and you were saying with our wastewater treatment facilities, there's that. And there's also going to be a pilot in Playa del Rey, where they're actually going to use with their incinerator, because they have all that new development, so they're going to be doing a food waste pilot in Playa del Rey with your garbage disposal. By the way, sorry, the garbage disposal was invented by a relative of mine, which is kind of an ironic thing. I get none of the royalties, though.
Massimo, the kind of food that you make at Osteria Francescana is very considered. The portions aren't huge. It's not this kind of abbondanza that one thinks of when thinks of home cooking or, you know, the Olive Garden. Do you think
I just want to listen to the question, and I want to see where she's going.
I really feel like chefs have such a power right now. Do you think that the conversation of the unwise sort of abundance can be addressed, because so much of what's wasted is driven by restaurateurs and chefs who want the illusion of abundance, knowing that at the end of the day there'll be a certain amount thrown away?
I don't think, I think restaurants right now in 2017 are different than 20 years ago. But you can see, you can read the moment, you know. Chefs right now are working to put ethic close to the aesthetic of their food. Using the ethic, the aesthetic without the ethic part is not beauty at all. The ethic part is extremely important part of what we do every day. Think about Osteria Francescana. Osteria Francescana is a laboratory of ideas. We produce culture, in which without Osteria, we couldn't do and we couldn't have the right attitude to do this kind of stuff. I can't dream without that. In Osteria, we produce culture. Think about the word everything. Ragu of everything. broth of everything, vegetable soup of everything. You know, everything is an enormous, amazing, powerful world in the right hands. If you have the knowledge to manage the word everything, otherwise it's a big mess. You understand? It's like, so we create this the plates that are everything, and we replicate this kind of words in the soup kitchen. I remember Ferran Adrià coming inside Milan and checking out everything, you know, and he tasted this bolognese sauce that I did the day before with everything I had. So I was opening almost expired pancetta plastic bag with mixing with you know, the vegetable I had, a lot of I use a lot of celery because there was not enough carrots and just few onions. Then I correct that with some intense meat because I had sweetness but not sapidity. Then I had a lot of turkey breast and a lot of bone marrow. So I did a ragu of everything, a bolognese sauce of everything. Ferran tasted and said, "Oh, this is fantastic. What is that?" I said, "Is the ragu made with what I had yesterday." So, and he used it for his plate because it was like, it's a passage. We were passing from one to another, all these kinds of things. In Brazil, I had to clean the refrigerator. I opened it and there was the whole refrigerator full of, you know, leftover from the other chefs. You know, I pass my knowledge to the volunteers. They are part of this project, and I teach them how to use those. So if you have a green, you know, vegetables, you can't put it and boil it. You have to saute, extract the flavor, let the water evaporate, and use and mix it with a potato that has been boiled. More, you know, you have some beans in a vacuum packed from Alex Atala, or like something from a Brazilian chef a Mexican chef. So I put together everything, all the culture, all the different culture, driven by my mental power, and that's why you need the chef. Okay. Because the chef, they are making visible the invisible for everyone.
So the people who are the customers who are eating this food, give us just a sense of that experience.
The customer who are eating?
The people who are, that the,
you're
our
feeding. Guests.
Yes, your guests. Yeah. Your guests.
Yeah.
Your guests who are eating this food. Because to me, the sort of extraordinary thing about your project is the soul. The soul that's in it, what it does to the people.
It's because, all about
so,
this.
Because it's, these are people.
If you don't have
this, you just go in your restaurant and think about how to make money. If you have a dream, you know, you don't have the, that as priority. You have to survive. You have to make money to pay the bill at the end of the month. But it's not my culture. I come from a different culture, and you know, to me, in my future, there always going to be future. I'm in a university. I believe in culture. I said yes because this is the place for culture, and in my dream is to build a university in Modena, and build a university in which the chefs, they will know more about soil and the future of the farmers. They will know more about taste. So if they grow together, they're going to respect much more each other. And this is this was like 5 years ago, a dream. Now, it's already been financed by the European community. It's going to be in the next 5 years, it's going to be a reality. So it's about this life. It's about having heart, soul, passion.
Calexit. I know that there's going to be there are questions that we have on cards. Are they coming? I don't think I can get up and take them from everyone. Is there someone here? Oh, here we have. Thank you, Massimo. Here's.
I'm checking the question. If I don't like them,
check control.
Yes, drum sorry. Style. Yeah.
Let's not go there.
There are more.
Yeah. I don't think I understand
not
this question.
Ready.
No. Do you use a bimbi? What's a bimbi?
I use a bimbi, yes, I do. It's a thermal mixer. Actually, it was one of the when I create this sauce that is a Parmigiano Reggiano sauce, is the historic compromise in Modena between the tortellini alla panna and tortellini in broth. You know, tortellini in broth is like the real, you know, integralist of the pasta with broth to taste the real feeling of the tortellini and the tortellini alla panna that the cheesemakers they were making like. And every single kid loves. I create this sauce with Parmigiano Reggiano that is like 3 years old, that is extremely, is already transformed the lactose in protein. And so is the perfect cheese also for kids. And using bimbi, I could make a sauce with water. Water and Parmigiano, because for me, water is truth. When you taste the sauce with water, it's true. I hate cream, butter, stuff like that, no? So I'm Italian, yeah. Not French. So I love this kind of lightness. And, you know, I made this sauce using the bimbi, starting at 55, with water at 55, arriving at 85, turbo, with grated Parmigiano Reggiano, and the sauce came out velvet.
Just water and cheese?
Yeah, and 30 years of experience. Yeah.
One of my students.
Okay. And we bring food for soul to UCLA.
This is for.
Okay.
Now invite me and I'm coming. Like in the middle of the. This is a good idea. In Los Angeles, do it, food for soul, in the middle of the campus would be amazing.
Amazing.
Let's do it. Give me a space. The students are going to be the volunteers. No, they're going to divide one day.
And they will also be the people who need to eat because
yeah.
Hunger
and they're
going to
be also the people that are going to. They're gonna be the new, you know, they're gonna receive all the knowledge from the chef. Mm-hmm. So it's gonna be the new.
I'm there.
No, that's good. That's a very good idea.
I'm there. Yeah. You convinced me. Okay. Amy, are you familiar with the Taiwanese model of recycling?
Taiwanese?
Yeah, in Taiwan.
I'm familiar with Japan.
Okay.
With
so
the fact that
Taiwanese
they...
is very good. That model is very good.
So, okay. So the recycling, I think it was like these several...
I know it. Do you want to know what it is?
Okay. So anyway, I'm not, but if it's anything to do with source separating, they have like, in Japan they have like 13 different bins. They actually recycle things by different material types. So I don't know if that's what they're talking about.
In Taiwan it happens on a block by block, street by street. Level and it becomes a community sort of moment where people have to physically come out and meet the truck.
I love it.
And
the ice cream truck song.
Yeah. Woo! Exactly.
All right.
So the music plays.
I
everybody comes. And
so it's an event.
It's an event, and if
oh
you don't
God.
Come,
call
you're
me.
Shame,
let's talk
I'm
about
imagine.
That.
Them from the government and they cost money.
Oh.
And the trash bags that you put, like, trash ones that you can't recycle cost more than recycling.
Oh. Yeah.
Did you hear?
Yes. So.
Yeah, sure. Do whatever you
want. So trash in Taiwan is separated into a lot of different bags, and you have to purchase these trash bags from the federal government. And ones that have like non-compostable, non-recyclable waste is more expensive than ones where you can put recycling in and things like that. And it's also like you have to buy it per bag, and you separate them into a bunch of different bags, and then they get thrown in the truck. That plays the ice cream truck song.
Okay, I love it, but...
Could that happen here?
Could I get anybody to do more than one blue bin? Let me tell you, it's a struggle. We still have people in the city of Burbank that think plastic bag is their birthright, so... But you know what? That didn't happen overnight, what they did in Taiwan. That happened over time, and that's a cultural thing. And it's a government, initiative where people in government had to make that policy and be brave about it, facing the wrath. So I'm sure at first as it was adopted, it was probably wobbly and maybe not as embraced, but now here it's this wonderful cultural thing that people get excited, and I love it. I'm all about that stuff.
Personally, I think we should change the tax system and people who manufacture or sell and have less impact on the planet should pay less taxes.
Yep.
And people who make more of a mess
it struggles in this country because everything has been built around cheap disposal. And so to do the right thing, that's why so many new technologies and green methods are always the more expensive option. Not always, but it's been that way traditionally because disposal has been so cheap. So if we start changing the model and how we fund these programs, that would actually be a huge step in doing the right thing. And Alameda County, if anybody's familiar with up north, they actually heavily tax their landfill. So that actually funds programs to support green and zero waste initiatives. So it's pretty cool.
So may I
suggest if you have a chance to watch the movie Wasted, produced by Anthony Bourdain. It's been shown at the Tribeca Film Festival, and it's going to
be
very,
at the
very interesting.
Yeah.
And from the 1st of June, Netflix bought Theaters of Life, the story of the 7 months at the refettori in Milan, and the life of the people this kind of experience. So it's very good.
So, Massimo, this is a total fan-based, non-food waste question.
My favorite ingredient.
What is your... No, not your favorite ingredient. Do you have a guilty pleasure when it comes to food? Do you know what this idea is, a guilty pleasure? Qualcosa che non devi mangiare perché sai che non è buono, però...
No, guilty pleasure.
I try to eat very well, so...
No Doritos, no Flaming Cheetos.
No, the point is, eat the right quantities, and have a good style of life. So if you talk with a kid and you say, don't eat Nutella, he's gonna eat Nutella all the time. It's like chocolate, not chocolate, because there's everything except for chocolate. fake, isn't it? And saturated fat. So it's like, but if you say don't eat it, he's gonna eat it. So the point is, you can have a spoon of Nutella, but also a pear, a piece of Parmigiano, and don't spend the whole afternoon in front of the computer. Mm. But just go and run and cook. The right style of life.
Okay, I'm juggling a lot here.
This is a good one. So, if we've got to the point where the food is no longer good, it's actually expired, not just expired because of stupid date, what can be done with it? Can it be transformed?
Well, okay, you mean it's actually got like, you know, fungus on it and things like that. Like, it's true.
It's rotten.
Because, you know, just a side note on the date labeling, that there's actually legislation being worked on right now in the state of California to organize that, because I don't know if you guys know, but there's really no rhyme or reason to date labels, the best used, sell by, all those things. There's nothing regulating that. It's more of what the manufacturers or the grocers are recommending as far as the guaranteed freshness of the product. So if you see an expired date, check the food. Don't just look at the expiration.
Your nose is there for a reason.
Right, and your eyes as well. But to answer your question as far as what you can do with it, I mean, obviously, you know, we're working on the infrastructure issue, as I mentioned earlier. But you can do a backyard compost if you've got that ability. The city of Burbank and Los Angeles, they actually give classes and also give discount, or in the case of Burbank, because we're awesome, we give free composters away. So you can take those skills and you can make your own organic soil amendment in your own backyard. But there's also other things, you know, like what, you know, how bad is it? Is the banana brown? Did, you know, are you gonna make
brown
something, right? We know that's the high sugar content. I'll tell you, when you have blemishes on your food, you know, cut around it or put it in a blender and make a smoothie. It's an amazing thing how you transform your food. If it may not look as appealing, but in a smoothie, you wouldn't know it anyway, right? So there's a lot of great tips on things like that at savethefood.com. I don't know if you've ever heard of that great website. They give a lot of tips on how to store food and also what types of things to do with it before and after it goes bad.
Also, you know, try not to shop when you're hungry.
And shop more often.
But recently...
Yeah, that's the most important thing.
It is.
It's the best recipe you can give to everyone. Is like, just dedicate more time to shop to yourself. To shop and buy seasonal ingredients. You save the money. And you buy the right amount for a couple of days. You keep in a refrigerator. So it's also a stimulation process for creativity. I have this, I have to cook something like this, I have to create something with this. Till you're done. At that point, you shop again. But it's like half an hour, not more. Maybe in Los Angeles a little bit more. Right?
You can always listen to a good podcast while you're going from place to place. In preparation for this, I actually came upon two articles. One was, and these are, using food for textiles. So one is a project in which kombucha scobies, you know, the weird little floaty thing that creates kombucha, is being used to make textiles. And more interestingly, in Sicily, there are a couple young women who created a project to deal with citrus waste, because it's such a huge problem in Sicily after they process juice.
Do you know why, no?
Yeah.
Because the Italian government made, and the European community, they made a deal with Libya to help the economy of Libya. And they buy and they import oranges from Libya. So there's not enough request for the oranges from Sicily. Think about it.
It's crazy, yeah.
And they don't have the money to pay people to harvest the fruit, the trees from the oranges, and leave the oranges like that.
And
the
so
oranges from Etna, the most amazing, the most volcanic soil, the blood and amazing.
And these oranges have a huge amount of essential oil, which is what gives them their aroma. So what these young women have been doing is working with chemists to take these excess citrus and turn it into a textile that is self-moisturizing. So you would wear a fabric that is imbued with oil from the citrus, and you would be bathed in deliciousness.
Yeah, but the plate, the recipe, oops, I dropped the lemon tart, it's about that. It's about the broken south of Italy. It's the most broken place in the world, you know? It's like, you. But when you walk on the Temple Valley, or you swim in Capri, or you taste an orange or a lemon or a caper from Pantelleria, you know, it's a dream. And it's about that. It's about the soil, the farm, the beauty of that. And it's like a contradiction of
south of Italy.
You know what I would love, because I know that we're going to have to wrap up soon and you're going to go sign books.
Me?
Yes, you, I think.
I have to go to eat.
Okay, maybe they'll bring you something while you're signing books. But I would love it if you could just paint us a picture, tell a story of when the Refettorio first opened and you started to serve people, and that moment of transformation in the person, which I think is another way of combating waste, right?
Yeah. each Refettorio has a totally different approach. One in Milan, we didn't know what to expect. So we were very, you know, a little bit nervous, scared, almost scared from the people. There were a lot of migrants at that time, you know, the problem of migrants that they passed through Milan, and but also homeless, but also normal people that, you know, they divorced from family, they lost the job, you know, they didn't have enough money to pay for a meal, so they were coming, you know. And the first 20 days, 3 weeks, you know, we had an approach also them, you know, they had an approach with us, like really humble, intimidate. They were walking in, eat in a half an hour, three courses being served, and they left. After like 3 weeks, you know, step by step, you know, there was like a celebration every day with chefs, people they were coming. Senegalese was a guitar player, was singing country and, you know, traditional African music for everybody, you know, it was amazing. In Rio de Janeiro was totally different, because we were serving the people of the neighborhood, you know, the people they were selling themselves, their body, 1 hour later, or like the kids they were running on the street, or like people they were sleeping in front of the and the refettorio. So it was like the neighbor that, but they were, you know, the article of, what really changed everything was Andrew Jacobs from the New York Times. When he volunteered, signed to be a volunteer, he came and he didn't introduce himself. And he spent a couple of days, and after that he said, "I am Graham Jackson from New York Times, I'm gonna write about you." And he wrote the real story of Rio de Janeiro, of the refettorio, and he said, interview one of the couple of the guests. You know, I was pinching my wife, say, "Dad, come on, but is it true? Are they really serving you like this? You know, we feel like prince and princess. You know, this is something that, you know, it's gonna stay with you forever." And change the whole perspective. All the press of the world was in line to come and check and volunteer and understand what was the situation.
I want to thank everyone for coming.